what is real-time messaging? What does this mean in the web space?
So in the web space, we're typically talking about things like WebSockets. But in the early days, there wasn't WebSockets, and the first thing that we probably did in the 10, 20 years ago was just keep pinging a server to see if there's any new messages, right? So quite inefficient, but kind of gets the job done. And then, we kind of figured out new ways of doing it. There's a technique called long polling, where you open a connection to the server and the server actually doesn't respond until there is a real-time update. So it's a little bit more efficient than keep polling all the time over and over again. And then for a while there, and I think it's, it still exists right now, there's a technology called server sent events that you can also use to kind of push real-time messages from a server to a client like a browser or even a mobile app. And then, in the last 5-10 years, WebSockets has kind of gone everywhere. And that seems to be what everyone's using these days. And you can actually work with WebSockets pretty easily just by, using just plain JavaScript in the browser and connecting to a WebSocket. But a library like Socket.io or SignalR, which we're talking about today, it's actually like an abstraction on top of it, I guess you can say. So what that means is that instead of actually, working with the raw WebSockets and actually working with the frames, sending frames to the server, getting frames back from the server, you're actually working at one or two levels above it. So you end up like, doing things like sending messages from the server to a client. Very much like you are just sending, pushing a message to a queue or something like that, or even just doing like a remote kind of procedure call type of thing. It's a lot more, natural. And then you can also get have access to kind of higher level concepts like, you can put a like connections into groups or rooms. Just, basically create arbitrary groups. So instead of like, keeping track of which of your users, which of your connections happen to be from, say, Seattle, and then you only want to send a message to only people in Seattle, without a library like that, you have to kind of manage all that yourself. And then when you need to send it, you actually literally have to iterate through all the different socket connections, WebSocket connections, and send these messages down. Whereas, with both Socket.io and SignalR and other kind of like libraries like it, you literally just make a call and say, hey, send this message to this group. And then it just does it. So a lot of the group and user management, it's all done for you. Another thing that the stuff like this will do for you is that you don't have to worry about what if my client, whether it's, it could be a super old browser, it could be, a fairly old, phone device that might not actually support WebSockets. These protocols will actually these libraries will actually fall back to the other kind of methods that I mentioned before, like server sent events or even long polling, so that you still program exactly the same way. You say send a message, but it figures out for that connection which protocol to use, so you don't have to worry about it. And think with connections and stuff like that, it's all built in.
Okay. So that way, if for whatever reason a browser didn't support WebSockets, that it's still able to thunk down to an earlier technology and guarantee me then that I'll be able to quote unquote send a real time message, even if it's not actually doing it with a real time stack.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
What? So we've sort of like mentioned that WebSockets is this cool new thing. What is WebSockets, and how does that compare to like HTTP or HTTPS?
Yeah. So it's a bidirectional protocol. So you can actually send messages from the server to a client, but clients can also send messages upstream. That's really the main difference. There's, if you look at the actual protocol itself, you kind of go pretty deep into the differences. But, for day-to-day use, that's really all you really need to know. You're sending these frames back and forth down this bidirectional channel.
Okay. So as opposed to, and I'm just going to simply say HTTPS, HTTP rather, but as opposed to just like normal HTTP, where what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a request, via post-get or whatever it is, and then get a response back. And then once that's done, then we basically tear down that connection and that's it. With WebSocket, then it sounds like I'm going to be able to almost treat it like it's on my network from what it sounds like, as if I was just able to just do a little TCP signal to it, only instead, obviously, it's a web-based protocol, where now I'm able to send a message up to the server, and then the server is at some later point able to send a message back down to me.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. All right. I can get behind that. So so SignalR, then, you mentioned that is, it's an SDK, that's something mm-hmm. that can help make it easier for me to start programming with WebSockets.
Yeah, so it's an SDK that came out of the ASP.NET world. You actually don't need ASP.NET to use it now that we have a service. And that's what we're actually going to talk about today. We're going to talk about how we can use JavaScript and Python code running in serverless functions and Azure Functions to work with SignalR service to basically get the same capability in other languages. As an SDK, I think there's multiple languages that we support in terms of clients. So web is obviously covered with JavaScript and TypeScript, but there's also a Java client, there's a C++ client. And throughout the community, there are different clients that are kind of produced in open source for things like Swift and Python and things like that.
Oh, that's interesting. So then from a client side, I'm not bound to only use a browser, that I could also mm-hmm. be using a FAQ client, like I could be using a phone app, or I could be using a desktop application and still be able to communicate with SignalR.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's quite flexible that way. And you kind of mentioned mobile. So one of the things that people quite often will kind of get confused by a little bit when talking about WebSocket technology is that this is not the push notifications on your phone that we typically talk about. That's typically very specific to whether you're using Apple or Google and stuff like that. So that's totally separate from WebSockets. WebSockets is when you have your app open. Say you open up a map, for example, for instance, you're looking for a car share and you kind of see the little cars moving around on the map. That's probably WebSocket. But when you close the app and you exit out and then, you get a notification from your app saying that your driver is here, that's typically a push notification that's sent another way. And that's not what we're talking about today.
Okay. And then I guess it also bears highlighting the fact that this is also different from those browser notifications that everybody is going to say no to, that's not what we're talking about when we're talking about WebSockets.
Right. Yeah, WebSockets is not annoying like that, no.
Okay. Cool. So WebSockets is really about being able to maybe create a chat application, or that maybe there's a long running process, I'm placing an order or doing something like that. The server's now going to do a few things. It's going to take it maybe 15, 30 seconds, a few minutes, and then now it wants to let me know that that's completed, that it can do that with WebSockets. Or I'm also thinking maybe if I'm watching or if I'm following a sporting event and somebody has scored, if I've got the mm-hmm. page open, then it can refresh the page then or update that piece of data using WebSockets.
Yep, exactly. Yeah, so there's just so many uses for it now. We don't even think about it anymore. When you open up a web page, you just expect things to just happen without you pressing the refresh button. I think we pretty much take that for granted now.
Yeah, so. I'd agree with that. Zimbabwe Dungeon Master, which is a great name, asked the question, is SignalR good for server-server communication, say for an old project where there's no gRPC?
Yeah, I think that should work fine. You obviously have to weigh the kind of pros and cons. You definitely have to opt into the to the protocol. So as long as you kind of own both sides, it's typically not too bad. If you want external services to connect to your service, quite often, like a old fashioned HTTP REST API type of a thing, will be easier for, you know, other services to use without kind of like binding yourself to a specific library like SignalR or Socket.io. But yeah, aside from that, it works well for that purpose. I've seen people use it, but for, you know, for generic kind of API for service, we do typically see people fall back to using HTTP APIs.
Okay. All right. That makes sense. And again, the key difference is we're always looking for the need for a two-way communication. That if all that I need to do is make a request, I get a response, and I'm good with that, then we can just, again, go back to HTTP. It's really if I'm looking for that ability to have two-way conversations.